So will you pray with me as we go before the Lord? Father God, we thank you for this time of worship, Lord. We know that you are in this space already, Lord, because we can feel you. You're moving from heart to heart and breast to breast. Now, Holy Spirit, I ask you to just fall fresh on me, Lord. Give me the anointing I need to do your will, Lord. Not my will. Lord, as you know, not my will, but let your will be done. Use me, empty me, and fill me with your grace and mercy so that I can preach the word that you have put in my heart. All this we ask in your son Jesus' name, amen. This morning, my text is pretty long. I know Chase is probably making a face at me as he shakes his head. We are reading Romans 5. We're going to read I want you to read the whole chapter, but we're not going to read all of the verses. We're going to jump around, but if you get a chance, please read all 21 verses. So those that are able to stand, will you please stand with me at this time? We start in Romans 5. We're going to start with verse 1. And 2, we're going to skip down to 6 and 8, 12 and 17, and end with 20 and 21. In the NIV, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we are now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Down to 6, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Jesus died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person. Though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Going down to 12. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, in this way, death came to all people because all sin. To be sure, sin was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a commandment, as did Adam, who is a pattern for the one to come. But the gift is not the transgression. For if the many died by the transgression of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of the one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift, somebody say the gift, followed many transgressions and brought justification. For if by the transgression of the one man death reigned through the one man, how much more those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of the righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Going down to 20. The law was brought in so that the transgressions might increase. But where sin increased, grace increased all the more, so that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through the righteousness to bring eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. You may be seated. My subject title this morning is Grace. 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 We all know something about grace. And grace may mean different things to each and every one of us, right? The Bible defines grace as God's unmerited favor, grace. Grace is what God does because God is good. Grace is the result of the love of God. Let me say that again. Grace is the result of the love of God. It is a gift given from God, freely given, not because of anything we have done, nor could ever do to earn it. Grace. Romans 11:6 says, if by grace, then it cannot be based on work. If it were grace, how much longer? But grace, it was a gift. It is a gift. And like any gift, we must choose to accept it. If you allow me a few minutes this morning, I would like to give us a better understanding of God's grace. Now, like many words that we've heard over our life journey in the church and in the community, grace is one of those words that have gotten a diluted meaning, I would say, over time. But I believe to truly, truly understand God's grace, we need to start by going back to the cross and to Jesus. See, for me, as we move further and further from Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday, the view of the cross starts to dim and fade a little. I don't know about for all of you, but for me, until we get back to that part again when we're excited about Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday, we start to stop thinking about the cross. You know, sometimes I feel like Peter, who took his eyes off of Jesus and started to sink. You know, we start to slowly stop trusting God and start trying to do things on our own. But to truly understand grace is to understand what Jesus did for us on that cross. We have been justified by Jesus on the cross. This means that there is no more condemnation. We are set free, free from sin, and with this freedom, there is peace. And that's something we can truly boast about in our suffering, which Paul talks about. Too many of us continue to condemn ourselves over and over again after being found not guilty. Let me ask you, if you were in the courtroom and the judge said to you, not guilty, why are we still standing there waiting to be sentenced? That's how we are with God. God says no more condemnation. You are forgiven. So why are we still beating up on ourselves from our past mistakes? And see, the good thing about God is his grace is new each and every morning. So when you mess up today, you know, after you leave church today and somebody cuts you off and you say the wrong thing or you get that text and, well, you know what I'm saying? God's grace is still abounding. You don't have to stop and give up. You are already saved by grace. Grace has freed us from the shackles of sin. You know, and our mistakes, they cannot no longer separate us from the love of God. You see, in the beginning, our purpose was to be in communion with God. And then, as the word said, that first sin happened. And what happened is that in that circle was torn and we were separated. And now there were two circles, the circle of the holy God and the sinful man. But Jesus knew, God knew just what we needed. And he sent his son to be the bridge, hallelujah, to bring those two circles back into communion. God didn't leave us alone to deal with the consequences of our sin, because the word said, just at the right time. And see, some people struggle with that, saying, well, that happened then. But I'm telling you, Jesus came just at the right time for the now. Do you understand? That's the same grace. You don't have to, Jesus doesn't have to come back again and die on the cross for our sins. When he's coming back to get us. So we need to be ready, all right? We need to stop beating up on ourselves, stop hiding, stop trying to wait till you're at that right moment in your life. The time is now. The end is near, right? We don't know the hour, but we need to be in right relationship with God. And Jesus came to be that way of reconciliation for us. So grace saves us and it reconciles us back into right relationship with God. For God demonstrated his own love for us while we were still sinners. Christ died for us. Grace is the result of the love of God. And God so loved the world that he gave the ultimate gift, his son. Now, you know, I thought I was a good gift giver. You know, I thought, you know, by now I have already bought everybody's gifts, because all year long I've been listening to what you like and, ooh, somebody wants this scarf or that CD or whatever. But God sent his son. He is the ultimate, the best gift giver out there. He gave his son for our lives because that's what we needed, and we didn't even know we needed it. Isn't that an amazing thing? That's the part about it, the amazing grace of God. Romans 3, 23. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by the grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Grace took all the consequence of our sin, the death we should and did deserve. There is no more condemnation. We are set free by the grace of God. We need to be reminded daily of the cross. It is not a one-time experience for us. Daily we should remember the cross. Daily we should look towards the cross. Daily we should pray for the grace of the redemption of the cross. We need grace so that we can be kind to our neighbors, right? We need grace to love our children. We need grace to forgive those who have sinned against us. I think about the parable of the unforgiven servant. You all know this parable. You may have found it. It's in Matthew 18, where Jesus is actually responding to Peter's question, how many times should I forgive my brother? And he talks about the parable and of the king in this kingdom, and compares it to heaven. And he says, the king wanted to reconcile the accounts with his servants. And one servant came and owed him 10,000 talents. But because he couldn't pay, the servant fell down to his knees and begged and said, please have mercy on me. And the king felt compassion, was moved by compassion, and forgave his debt. But in the same moment, that same servant went to his fellow servant who owed him only 10 denaro and said, oh no, throw him in jail. He had no mercy for him. And so that king came back and said, what? You have no, you too shall. See, this is what God does for us. God has said, I paid it all for you. And in that same way, just like I have forgiven you, we need to forgive each other. And there is no limit on the amount of time we, or times we should do it. Because God has not limited how much he has done this for me. He had compassion for us. He has love for us. The message is God's grace forgives, and thus we should forgive even more. I think about the scripture that talks about how can you love me who you don't see, but yet you hate your brother who you see every day. Shame on us. Shame on us. God loves us, and thus our response to God's love is to love each other. Amen? So grace saves, and grace justifies, and grace forgives. And although grace is a gift, God will never force it on us. Just like any gift, in order for you to enjoy the gift, you have to accept it. I can give you, everyone in here, a gift. If you never open it up, it's just an empty box to you. It's just sitting there with no value. He wants us to accept what he has given us so that when we open it up, we can enjoy it. And when we're enjoying it, we are following his will. And his will is for us to turn, to repent from what we used to do so that we can do his will. I thank God for the gift of his grace, because I'm not what I used to be. And I'm not saying I'm where I'm supposed to be, but I sure am not where I used to be. Amen? Amen. I know God has a plan and a purpose for me, and together we are working it out as I continue to allow the Holy Spirit to work in my life. That's grace. Amen? And the good news is, like I said, even if you mess up, all you have to do is repent and know that God will pour out more grace and mercy on you. Whatever you have done, are doing, or will do, grace, God's grace, is new each and every morning. God's grace restores us back into right relationship with him because of what Jesus did on the cross. We are not just saved from sin, but we are restored, and we are reunited back to our Heavenly Father. Grace saves us, grace restores us, and grace brings us back into right relationship with God. In Paul, we find God's grace is sufficient. Paul had to deal with some great difficulties as he transitioned from being a persecutor to a follower of Jesus Christ, amen? And he also had some physical and medical issues he had to deal with. But he learned how to be content in any situation. Can I say that about us? Have we learned how to be content and know that God's grace is sufficient? Paul cried out to God 3 times, please take this thorn from me. And what did God say? My grace is sufficient because I delight in weakness. You know, when you are weak, then my grace abounds strongly. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in it. This is what Paul said. I delight in the insults and the hardships and the persecution and the difficulty, because when I'm weak, through the grace of God, then I am strong. How many of us have pleaded with God to change their situation? Lord, I wish I had a new job, a new boss. Father God, I can't even take this car anymore, and these kids are getting on my nerve, and if that foolish man walks up here one more time, just one more time, Lord. How many of us have done that? But I say to you this morning, trust in the Lord and lean not to your own understanding. Know that God is fully aware of your situation, is present in the midst of them, and is acting in wisdom and power and love to accomplish what's best for you. I want to say that again. God is fully aware of your circumstance. He is in the present midst of it right now, and he's there with you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And he's acting in wisdom to work it out for your good. His grace is sufficient. Amen. Not only is his grace sufficient, but there is power in his grace. Power so that you can have the courage to overcome the things that you are struggling with. Power to be strong when you are weak. Power to just lean on God. Grace. Grace saves. Grace restores. Grace justifies. And grace gives us power. The law was brought in so that the transgressions might increase. But where sin increased, grace increased all the more. This verse right there, I think, is the whole beauty of grace. Where sin increased, God's grace increase all the more, shows us the depth and the breadth of Jesus's or God's grace. That no matter how much we sink into sin, God's grace is deeper enough to reach in and pick us out of that muck and mire. Amen? How many of us have known or been there, have been sinking deep in sin, far from that peaceful shore, but the Master, hallelujah, lifted you. That's grace. That's God's grace. It is abounding more and more than any sin that the world can give you. Don't give up on God. Trust and believe, God will never give up on you. He will go to the ends of the earth to get you back. Trust and believe, God loves you. I want to close with this. Grace, although it is given freely, this is that, and it's given freely, that it can save us, that it can restore us, that it can forgive us, and there's nothing we can do to earn it. It is not cheap. I don't want you to get that twisted. Just because it's free, grace is not cheap. Jesus shed his blood to pay the price for grace. The German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his book, The Cost of Discipleship, wrote, "Grace is costly because it condemns sin, and grace because it justifies the sinner. Grace is costly because it condemns sin, and grace because it justifies the sinner." That's me, and that's you. Jesus is grace. I say that again. Jesus is grace. Jesus paid it all. All to him we owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Blind, but I can see. Grace, grace, God's soul-saving, life-changing grace. Amen? Amen. Amen. I don't know how many of you know something about grace. I know about grace. I know about grace that when I should have been dead for the type of lifestyle I was leaving, it was only because of grace. When I walked into that building and things was going on that I shouldn't have been in, it was only grace that got me home safe. Hello? Somebody know about grace? I just need one witness that knows about grace, that picked you up and turned you around. The places you used to go, you don't go anymore. The thing that pricked your heart to the point that you said, that's not for me no more. Grace, God's abounding grace is free to us all. And at this time, if you want to come and thank God for his grace, if you haven't experienced God's grace, if you want to just get closer to God, the doors of this church is open. This space right here is a sacred space where we can pray to God. There's some people we need to pray for who are struggling and haven't gotten a touch of God's grace. But I pray that you will be that instrument to help them find their way, because grace is all we have, and Jesus is our grace. Amen. Or maybe you just want to thank God for another week that he saved you from death. Amen. Chase said earlier, this violence has been out in the community where you're 91 years old and you can be physically attacked. Only but grace saved her. Only but grace. Or that these young kids are riding buses and sitting on their porches. It's only but grace that can divert a bullet. I don't know about you, but I know I need to thank God for his grace. Amen. Robin, you will sing us a little song while people decide. Gracious Heavenly Father, a God that can touch and give sight to the blind, a God that can touch and regulate the pain in our body, a God who breathes on us, and his grace is sufficient. We thank you, Lord, for this word. We thank you, Lord, for this time. Lord, we ask that you would meet the needs of those that are standing here right now, and then those that are listening on YouTube, Lord, whatever we are holding in our heart, we know is not secret with you, Lord. So touch, Lord. Stir up in us new courage and strength, Lord, so that we can be witnesses of your amazing grace. Tell our stories. Share our experience. There's no shame on this side of grace. Hallelujah. There's no shame. Savior like Jesus. Tell the story of how he got up on that cross, spread his arms wide, hung his head and died. But the story didn't end there. He got up so that we can have life, a restored, justified, redeemed life. I pray that every day is a resurrection Sunday for us, that we can walk boldly knowing that it's only by grace that I'm standing before you. Lord, heal where there needs to be healed, Lord. Regulate what needs to be regulated. And we will continue to give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In the precious name of the only true and living God, in the name of Jesus who died for us.